Okay, today's lecture has to do with Mary Poppins. So I always use this example, and I become more and more irrelevant every year because fewer and fewer students have actually seen the original Mary Poppins. But if you did see it, it took place in the late 1800s in London, England. And one thing you notice is this really stark darkness about the city of London at that time. And the reason it's dark is because everything is covered in soot. So if you look at what was going on in London at that time, it was the Industrial Revolution, and everybody was being powered by coal. And coal is dirty, and that soot covered everything, the streets, the building, and the trees. So during that time, there was a bug called a gypsy moth. And gypsy moths were pretty close to being white. So they got hit really hard during the Industrial Revolution because birds could see them very, very well. If you're a white moth and you're on a black building, the birds don't have any trouble picking you off. And that's exactly what happened. Now, moths, just like people, their babies have genetic variations. So just like you don't look exactly like, unless you're an identical twin, you don't look exactly like your siblings, moths are the same way. Some of them are a little darker, some of them are a little lighter. And so what happened was, if you're a mother gypsy moth and you have babies, most of those babies are gonna be white. But every so often, one of them will be off-white. Now here comes the birds. Who do you think gets eaten? The white ones. They're easy to see. So the off-white ones now have babies, and their babies are mostly off-white, but every so often they'll have a gray one. So again, the birds come in, wreak havoc, and who gets eaten? Now it's the off-white ones that get eaten. The gray ones survive, and the gray ones have babies, and they mostly have gray babies, but every so often they'll have a black one. And birds come in again and eat all the grays. So now what we saw is in a very short period of time, these gypsy moths changed from being white to being black. That's natural selection. It's survival of the fittest. Animals that have the most adaptive characteristics survive, and animals that don't get kicked out of the gene pool. They don't live long enough to have babies, so their genes aren't carried on in the species. Now, if you get sick and you go to the doctor, you've got an infection, and they give you antibiotics, he hands you a bottle of pills, and he says, be sure to take all of them. Now, why does he tell you that? It's exactly like the moths. Those little germs that are attacking your body, when you take antibiotics, the first dose you take kills off the weaklings. And the ones that are strong and antibiotic resistant survive to have babies. So the doctor tells you to take all of your medicine so that you make sure that you kill everybody and there's no super strong bugs left. We currently have antibiotic resistant infections because of antibiotics, that antibiotics were used to kill off the weaklings and the strong ones survived to create stronger strains. Okay, so you've heard this sort of analogy to explain natural selection. Does it sound weird to you? Does it sound controversial in any way? Because it shouldn't. It's just the way it is. It happens. Evolution is what happens. Okay, so it's impossible to teach psychology without teaching evolution, because so many of our psychological issues are traits that were very adaptive 10,000 years ago, but are sometimes not very adaptive in a modern society. So think about racism. We've got lots in the news right now about Black Lives Matter and some of the horrible things that are going on, and also some wonderful things and people coming together. There's a lot of talk about, when will racism end? I don't know that it will. Racism really is a pretty much inborn, hardwired part of the human psyche. And here's why. Imagine you're a cave person and you live in a small tribe of about, 12, 20 people, something like that. And you guys are living off the land and sitting around your campfire, and all of a sudden, over the hill comes another tribe, and they don't talk the same language as you. They don't dress the same as you. And tribes that were scared or who responded with violence, with either violence or running away, fight or flight, were allowed to stay in the gene pool. The sort of hippie tribe that says, hey, y'all come on over here. Well, what happened was they got wiped out and they got lost all their resources. So it was an adaptive trait a long time ago, and now it's a really maladaptive trait. So as far as racism goes, there are all kind of maladaptive traits. If you look in the animal kingdom, animals rape and murder constantly. They steal. And yet, hopefully, most of us don't rape, murder, or steal. And it's been socialized out of us. We still have the hard wiring to do horrible things, and some people do. But the truth is that we've been socialized in a way to override that hard wiring. And that's the way you get rid of racism. So in psychology, many of these traits that we have were super adaptive. They kept us in the gene pool for thousands of years. But now that we live in a modern civilized culture, many of those traits don't fit anymore. I'll give you an example of some sort of obvious evolutionary traits, okay? Human beings suffer from phobias. I'm scared of heights. Think about the most common phobias. People are scared of heights, they're scared of animals, they're scared of the dark, they're scared of water, they're scared of tight, closed-in places. What do all those things have in common? Well, they're all issues that had to be dealt with by early man. Snakes. A lot of people are scared of snakes. That is an adaptive trait for a caveman. How many people you know have been killed by snakes lately? It's not particularly rational to be afraid of snakes now. If phobias were not the result of evolution, or the most common phobias, you can actually be phobic to anything. You can learn to be scared of, stuffed animals. But the common phobias were all things that early man had to deal with. If phobias were rational, we'd be scared of getting in the car. We're much more likely to die in the car than anywhere else. We'd have phobias to hand grenades and bombs and guns and those kind of things. And those are actually fairly rare phobias. So if you look at a problem that you have, or an issue, a disorder, a lot of times you can trace it back to its evolutionary roots. And the fact that we're sort of hardwired does not mean we can't overcome those issues. So I'm scared of heights. But when I was in high school, I had to paint my parents' house, and it was like a three-story house, really high. So I get an extension ladder and I put it all the way up there, and I put a, peg in the ground to make sure it doesn't slide, and I climb up that ladder and I'm shaking, man, I'm scared. Well, I start painting, and about 30 minutes later, I am no longer scared. I'm on this ladder, I'm stretching up, I'm on the top rung, stretching up to the top of painting, and no fear. I overcame that fear by exposure. And that's actually the way to overcome all fears, is expose yourself to the object that you're afraid of. Also, though, a phobia will come straight back if you don't continuously expose yourself to that stimuli. So because I don't work on ladders or climb on roofs or trees or anything for a living, I'm scared of heights again. So the question I want you to ask yourself is, what are some evolutionary traits that you can think of that were very adaptive back in the day for cavemen, but are no longer adaptive in a modern culture? So think about that, come up with your insights on that, and then share them with me when we meet online.